The Chicago Outfit, also known as the Chicago Mafia, the Chicago Mob, or the Organization, was an Italian-American crime syndicate based in Chicago, Illinois, and dated back to the 1910s. The outfit rose to power in the 1920s under the control of Johnny Torrio and Al Capone, and the period was marked by bloody gang wars for distribution of illegal alcohol during Prohibition. Since then, the outfit has been involved in a wide range of criminal activities, including loan sharking, gambling, prostitution, extortion, political corruption, and murder. Following Capone's conviction for income tax evasion, the outfit was run by Paul Rica and Tony Arcato, Vita Monaco and Tony Monaco, for more than 50 years after Frank Nitti killed himself instead of going to jail. Arcato took over as boss sometime in the 1940s and was one of the longest-sitting bosses of all time up until his death in the early 1990s. The outfit did not have a monopoly on organized crime in Chicago, but they were by far one of the biggest criminal organizations in the Midwest. Chicago's change for the worse, or to the worst, was exactly coincidental with the beginning of Prohibition. This is mostly due to Al Capone's arrival in Chicago in 1920, when he inherited the leadership of Torrio's gang. It is important to note that this is the same year Prohibition became enforced, although ratified in 1919. Capone had a brilliant criminal mind, and he focused it on organizing an international bootlegging ring. He coordinated the importation of alcohol from different locations, including other states and even Canada, as well as the operation of hundreds of breweries and distilleries, many of which resided in Chicago. Capone also devised a system to distribute his alcohol, which involved delivery truck drivers, salespeople, and speakeasies, equivalent to a bar, and of course heavily armed bodyguards to protect the investments. Ain't that a kick in the head? The room was completely black. I hugged her and she hugged back. Like the sailor said, quote, ain't that a hole in a boat? Higher law enforcement investigations and general attrition led to the outfit's gradual decline since the late 20th century. The decline of the entire mob would never truly occur, just the killing, arresting, or fleeing of high-ranking gangsters such as Al Capone. The families of victims of massacres or killings carried out by the mob will forever feel the effects, along with the government, in seeing that they have little power over such influential, cunning individuals. The city of Chicago will forever see the effects of its history, and not only the things left behind, but in society itself.
One horrific event carried out by Al Capone and his men took place on the morning of February 14th, when a group of George Bugs Moran, a longtime enemy of Capone, gathered at the Clark Street Garage. One of the men, named Johnny May, an ex-safecracker who had been hired by Moran as an auto mechanic, he was working on a truck that morning with his dog, a German Shepherd named Highball, tied to the bumper. In addition, six other men waited for a truck of the promised hijacked whiskey to arrive. The men were Frank and Pete Gusenberg, who were supposed to meet Moran and pick up two empty trucks to drive to Detroit and pick up smuggled Canadian whiskey. James Clark, Moran's brother-in-law, Adam Heyer, Al Weissenhock, and Reinhard Schwimmer, a young optometrist who had befriended Moran and hung around the liquor warehouse just for the thrill of rubbing shoulders with gangsters. George Moran was already late for the morning meeting. He was due to arrive at 10:30 but didn't even leave for the rendezvous. In the company of Willie Marks and Ted Newberry, until several minutes after that, as the seven men waited inside the warehouse, they had no idea that a police car had pulled up outside, or that Moran had spotted the police car and was driving south on Clark Street rather than dealing with what he believed to be a shakedown, and stopped at the next corner for a cup of coffee. Five men got out of the police car, two of them in uniforms and three in civilian clothing. They entered the building, and a few moments later, the clatter of machine gun fire broke the stillness of the snowy morning. Soon after, five figures emerged and they drove away. May's dog, inside the warehouse, began barking and howling. This alerted the landlady in the next building, Miss Jeanette, who was bothered by the sound of the dog, and sent one of her boarders, C.L. McAllister, to the garage to see what was going on. He came outside 2 minutes later, his face a pale white color. He frantically ran up the stairs to beg Miss Lesterman to call the police. He cried that the garage was full of dead men. Unknowingly, they had stumbled upon what would later be known as the victims of the Valentine's Day Massacre, a horrific event carried out by Al Capone that took the lives of many men who were gangsters in a rival North Side gang of Al Capone. You are my one love, my life I live for.